But instead, he'll be able to make it here in time before he gets into this country and start sieging my capital here and my national focus, which is what he'll probably continue doing, and I'll probably have to come back and fight him with my larger pooled army. So I'm gonna merge these guys, and I'm gonna send them to Madras here, and I'm gonna try to get the rest of these guys into my army, and I'm gonna let him siege Bangalore here because that's probably what he's gonna do. And because he's gonna do that, and this guy's almost built here, I don't really wanna continue wasting that money. I don't know if I'll be able to recruit much of it because, well, if this guy's in this battle, there's a very good chance he's just gonna defeat every single one of them. So I'm gonna try to stop the recruitment of that troop there. See how much money I get back. Okay, I didn't get all of it back, but I got about half of it back. So they're not just gonna die for nothing. And I think it went back into my manpower pool. Royal marriage offer from Gondwana here. I'm gonna go ahead and accept that because they may be, who knows, they may be a good future ally to continue my war with the Khan. One thing I'm gonna do. Okay. The fortress is under siege here. And what happened when my forces, this thing popped up, is my game automatically paused. There's a way you can change this. You can right-click any one of these things that come up and is basically say, okay, see, when an enemy lays siege to one of our fortresses, you have another number of options here that you can basically tell the game to do whenever this event happens. What I chose to do is just open in a pop-up window, and then I have also have here pop up and pause. So basically the game will pause, so I'll be able to react to that situation without the game just speeding right along. And so that's why I like to do the things that are really important for me to be able to have react to a decision to. I like to pause the game so I can make that decision. And if you look in the bottom left, this little event window here, you can actually right click any one of these text lines and bring up the same thing that that corresponds to whatever specific game type of event that is. So say this one. So whenever an advisor from your country is hired by another country, or say another country has a certain event, if you want to know about that stuff instead of it just popping down here, you can open up a pop-up window, you can pause it, you can show it on map, which will zoom it to where that event's happening. But most of these things that are happening with other countries, you don't really care about, so I don't have them have a pop-up or anything. I don't really give a damn about what's going on in those other countries, unless it's, certain important things like a military alliance, or one country's annexing another one, or one country's waging war on another one, which right now I also don't really care about. If it's not affecting me, I don't have a pop-up on there because I can find that stuff out later if I want, but it's not really that pertinent for me unless I'm wanting to take advantage of the fact that two nations are waging wars, and I want to pick on one of them. Okay, so this army is in Bangalore right now. He's basically sieging my capital. If I click on my city here, I'm holding out for years, garrison of 1,000, and they have all their guys. So there's a very good chance that they'll siege this until they occupy it, because it's my capital and something that I'm going to give up easily just because they're occupying it, but that's not going to be the case. I'm going to take these guys, move them up here to Madras, and hope that he doesn't intercept them before I actually get there, because I want to be able to have a large army with a relatively high morale to be able to squash them and get them on the run. And once I can defeat that large army, I don't think they have any more large armies roaming around, so I might be able to just occupy, conquer their cities while they're trying to recruit another army, and basically get them running and not never let them recover. So as these guys get here, I'm just gonna keep merging them in. Of course, every month, as you see, these little numbers that are popping up, and of course the yearly thing happened too, so the large numbers popped up. I got my monthly income and I got my yearly income. status quo, so that's pretty good. Still, changes. The city's still holding out, but that could easily change to a food shortage or a water shortage in no time at all. So I want to keep an eye on when they're sieging my cities just to make sure it's not going to be captured. What happens in this game when a province is captured is quite different than most other games like... Oh, damn it. It's quite different than most other games like Total War. Because when you capture a province, you don't immediately own it. You're just occupying it. And basically, as you're going around occupying enemy provinces, you're not really gaining anything from them, but they no longer are able to manage out of them. They can't recruit troops out of them. And for every province that you own, it increases your victory points here, which basically, water shortage, as you can see. But anyway, what that basically does is gives you more of a chance to negotiate peace terms, either in your favor or in the enemy's favor, to stop the war and get what you want, whether you want some countries that you have occupied, or whether you want some ducats, or whether you want to vassalize them, or make them change their religion, or whatever. But now that I have my guys here, and the city's at a water shortage, which probably surrender, it says here, in 9 months, I want to take my army now, which is full morale, and 12,000 men. Still, it doesn't have as many cavalry as the... as my enemy here, but I'm hoping my superior numbers will be able to help squash these guys here and get them routing before my my country, my capital here surrenders. Because this is my capital, my national focus, I really want to protect it well. But as you can see here, you can change your capital. And you can change your national focus, but when you do, and it gives certain benefits, but when you do so, it takes a long time before you're able to do it again. Sometimes up to like 50 years or whatever. So if you change one of those, you really, really want to change it for a good reason. Be able to live with the consequences of doing so. Okay, and they're sieging that province now too. I'm not liking the way this war is going right now, but if I can win this battle and get these guys routing and keep chasing them and chasing them and chasing them, I'm able to beat them, which would be a good thing, and I might be able to turn the tide of this war. Okay, so my army is almost there. And when it gets there, it's going to kind of stop the siege because these two armies are going to have to fight with each other like they're doing right now. Sometimes when I'm in a battle like this, I like to sort of slow the game down and be able to watch it as it's going on to see whether I'm winning or losing. Or you can do it at a higher speed. It doesn't really matter. When you're fighting a battle, you have these dice rolls which sort of kind of simulates how the battle's going, whether one side currently has the advantage or one side doesn't. Like, the dice just changed for them, the dice 1 rather than the dice 6 they were at before. And so that I currently have the advantage because I have dice 4, but my terrain is lowering my advantage by 2 because I'm on the attack from Madras to Bangalore. So they have the terrain advantage. And right now I have a dice of 0 and negative 2, so I'm, this cycle of the battle, I'm really getting my ass kicked. And I'm losing, but I'm hoping that it'll kind of switch around a little bit, and I'll be able to take advantage and rout my enemy by reducing them around. But it looks like right now I might be losing this battle, which is really going to suck because it's not so good for this video. But I may have been a little bit premature in waging this war, but we'll see. Hopefully I've been able to teach some important concepts like how to lose a war. Well, my friend here looks like he's routing one of the armies of Khan, so that's kind of good. And they're sending more out, so maybe things might turn around. Who knows? I'm really not liking these dice rolls these guys are getting, because they're staying at nine, and I'm really getting my ass hammered. As you can see, during the battle, the morale goes up or down, depending on, I guess, just the way things are going. I'm not exactly sure why it's going up and down. Yeah, my morale's going up, and theirs is going down, even though my rolls are still lower. It's kind of confusing, but... the most important thing to take stock in when you're waging war with the nation is that morale. Morale is incredible. Oh, like you can see, morale is incredibly important. And my morale just really dropped there. Okay, so because of this battle, I lost, on the left here, I lost, this P stands for prestige, so I lost 2.8 prestige, which my prestige is now negative. And this has certain effects on the way nations view me. My T, which I'm not quite sure what T is. And because of I lost that battle, my war exhaustion went up by 3.13, which is awful. My war exhaustion is currently 5.51 at 18. Because I'm losing the battle, my citizens are basically, they're getting exhausted with this war, and they don't want it to happen. I can't believe I lost that battle. But... eh, things happen. Maybe I'll be able to come back and fight them, and maybe my allies will be able to help out. But as you can see, they're currently moving in to Deccan. I still have too many armies, so my maintenance is... I'm paying 18% more than what I normally would be, because I'm up from my support limit of by 2 points. But I'm in war, so sometimes you need to do things like that. I'm hoping my ally here will be able to kind of draw the attention away from my Deccan neighbors here, get them back into their country so I can be able to, one, not have these two countries occupied and have to be able to take them back, but then be able to take the fight back to them again on their own land. Under my terms. So one thing, what I'm going to do actually, I'm going to recruit some mercenaries. Because I have some money. So I'm going to recruit some mercenaries, and maybe that'll help me push them out. I've never usually recruited mercenaries, but right now, I can see that it really has a possibility of helping me out to win this war. So I'm going to take the risk here. And I don't really have enough to recruit but too many of these guys, so I'm going to instead go with the infantry here, the soldiers. Okay, I'm a little bit confused now with the cost of why I was moving them down the list, but... oh, and I believe... with the mercenaries here, it's all based on region. So if you don't recruit those mercenaries, the enemy might be able to recruit them from you. And because there's only a limited pool of mercenaries out there in a region, and the enemy might snatch them up before you do, and you'll have to wait a while before they regenerate. Okay, so my buddy here, Orissa, is actually coming to my defense, and Kandavidu, I hope I'm pronouncing that right, probably, but they're coming to my defense here, and maybe this guy will come and attack them there, and I'll be able to kind of swoop in and turn the tide of battle. Okay, I lost the siege of Bangalore. Now they are occupying it. It took 226 days, which is almost a year, two-thirds of a year, so let's... it takes a long time sometimes in these games, especially for much more advanced cities. But just because it's occupied by Deccan here doesn't mean that it's owned by them. As you can see, it has this cross, these hash marks here. That means it's owned by me, but it's occupied by Bangalore. And as a result, it's changed the victory status, or the war status. So now it's in negative 11%, which means that the Deccan has a an advantage over me by 11%, they'll be able to take this 11% victory points and be able to basically offer me surrender terms, whether I want to give them Bangalore, which I'm not going to do because that's my capital, or like if this was higher, up to 90% or 100%, like if I completely conquered all their properties and I was at 100%, because for each one it's a certain percentage of that total, I have 100 victory points, 100%, 100 victory points to be able to use to negotiate terms. And if you're at 100%, you can do things so radical, like completely annexing the entire nation if you're occupying all their territories. Or maybe making them demand more money. For every demand that you give, which I'll show you, every demand tribute, so I'm at negative 11. My war score, okay, that's what it's called, war score, is negative 11%. So for every thing that I do that I demand from them or offer to them, my peace value offer goes up a little bit. Like if I want to force vacillation, that's going to require 172 war score points, which is it's completely impossible right now because my war score is so low, and I'm not even going to be able to possibly do that. I can have them concede defeat, but of course they're winning the battle, so they're not going to do that. Because I would need like a war score of maybe 11% on my side or higher for them to be able to accept that. You can see when you're changing these things on the bottom here, you can see what they think about that offer, what they would think about that offer. Right now, of course, they're not going to accept it because I'm the aggressor in this war. So, like, if I wanted to offer tribute to stop the war, I can concede defeat, and they still won't accept it because they like the fact that they're winning this battle. And they want to continue it. They want to get more for the war. So they're not gonna possibly stop the war right now because they're winning. They think they're winning, and they're gonna keep wanting to win. So right now, I mean, I'm not even interested in conceding defeat. So I'm just gonna keep fighting them and make them either offer a white peace to me or concede defeat and give me some of their provinces, which I'm not going to accept a white peace because I really want, I started this war and I want to get something from it. But we'll see how things go. See, as I thought, they're going from Bangalore to Khandavidu, so that's good. August, about 10 days, and then I'm gonna move these guys back out. Okay, so my allies moved from Khandavidu to Bangalore before they managed to get from Bangalore to Khandavidu, or Khandavidu. So that's good. And they already lost the battle, and they're coming over here. Looks like my allies kind of bit off more than they could chew there. Yeah, gonna get screwed for it. So I got my mercenary, and I'm gonna go back and try to wage war. And try to beat this battle because I have more guys now, and I hope their morale is kind of lowered. Okay, see, they moved their main army to Khandavidu while their other one had retreated to Bangalore. And I'm gonna be able to squash that smaller army with my larger army, and if I can squash it good enough and maybe completely eliminate them and then move on to this army. But they're still sieging Golconda here, so hopefully they'll be able to occupy this capital while they're too busy focusing on my territories. And great, they moved all the way over to another province. They're basically getting to where they want to go before I get to them, and that's something you really have to keep in mind. They may be out of the country before you get into it. this battle is going to go very well in my favor. In fact, they have so few guys, I'm going to completely destroy everyone they have. As you can see, they had 772, and they lost 772. There's no more left for them. And so I'm going to take the morale of that victory and apply it to this battle and hopefully get the enemy routing all over the place. Things are looking good. I have more than double their infantry, about a third of their cavalry, but I'm hoping that, due to my superior numbers, I'll be able to turn the tide of battle. And my maintenance, as you can see, is like 100% more than what it's supposed to be. Yeah. So I'm paying a crap load of money. As you can see, my monthly income is 7.5, but my expenses are 17.7. And one thing most people might do when they're faced with these war expenses is they're going to increase their treasury. And you could do that, but like I said, it'll increase your inflation. You may be able to balance your budget while at war, or be close to it, but you're going to increase that inflation, which in the future is going to harm you because everything is going to be more expensive. So even though I'm in war, I'm going to try to keep on waging this war, and if I can, hopefully, once I destroy this army, kind of reduce the numbers of my army, because I have way too many guys. It's costing me way, way too much money. And so I'm going to go bankrupt if I'm not too careful. Or I can take out loans, which it'll take 5 years, and that's an option to do if you're trying to get a couple more months to the end of the year taxes. Like this is November, and if I'm trying to wait till January, I will get my 53, but I'm still, because I'm losing 10 per month, I'm going to be bankrupt, and every time you get to zero or below, you're going to take a loan, and eventually you're going to have to declare bankruptcy, which had some serious negative effects on your nation, if you have so many loans that you can't repay. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to take a loan. It's not going to be a whole lot, it's just going to be 44, but right now that'll afford me 4 months of war. It's not a whole lot, but I'll have to worry about paying that off in the future, once I'm at peace. One of the things that would have been good for me to do is have a commander, but it was so expensive for me before to recruit a commander that I didn't really want to do that because I needed the money to do it, but it would have increased my chances of winning some of those early decisive victories. Okay, I won that battle, but you see, they still have some of their guys left. In fact, they have most of them left, and they're retreating to Bangalore. But what I'm going to do, while the game is still paused, I'm going to think about where they're retreating to. Oh wait, they're going to Raichur Dwab. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to send my guys after them. Their army is routing, and I'm going to chase after them. And I'm going to be able to arrive where they arrive before, or a little bit after they do, but before they're able to go from here to one of these other countries. So I'm going to be able to catch them when they're still demoralized, when, you know, they're still licking their wounds, and I'm going to be able to crush them again. And if you keep doing that several times, especially when they don't have a leader, there's a good chance you're just going to completely annihilate every last man and be able to have that total battle victory against them. And once that happens, it's going to take them a while to be able to build an army of such a size again. And so I'm going to take that opportunity to recapture Bangalore and then go on the offense here and occupy their provinces like they were doing to mine. So they're going to arrive. We're going to arrive, since we left at the same time, we're going to arrive at the same time. And like I said, their morale is still going to be really low. And I'm going to be able to have another easy victory on them. And this guy will be involved in the fight as well, because he's not going to be able to arrive here before we arrive here. And so they'll still be in the country when these guys get in the country, and they'll be fighting alongside me in the battle. Ah, this is going to be satisfying. Their morale's not as bad as I thought it was going to be. However, my ally here, he has a leader. This gives us some shock value and some maneuver value, which really affects our ability to basically affects our ability to win this battle. And as you can see, they lost some more guys, but they still have some more left. And they are now retreating from Rachur Nawab to Konkan, which is actually the place that I want to take over so I can get my my core on it. So I'm going to chase them again, since they don't have any other armies, and I'm not worried about their taking me over. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to recruit a regiment. And what I'm going to do when I do that... that's going to take 101. Okay, well, I'm going to recruit this regiment, and then I'm going to send him over here, so he'll be able to reoccupy this province, hopefully, if we can get past the garrison that they're now garrisoning the city. And so I can do that while my other armies are doing their campaign over here. Which right now, things actually look really good for my nation, because we're defeating their largest army here, and they don't have anywhere near as many guys as me, there's a good chance I'm going to be able to crush them before my war exhaustion gets too high, which right now it's fairly high. But once I can take back Bangalore, and maybe hopefully take Konkan and Rachur Nawab, maybe they, as part of their surrender terms, they'll offer me both of these. And then I'll be able to get a core on Konkan. But we'll see. Once again, I'm initiating the attack. They got here first, and I got there after them. So the terrain advantage is in their favor and against me. I'm penalized for it. They lost again, and they're going back to Rachur Nawab. Sometimes, like I said, it can take a while before they're completely crushed. I mean, you're not necessarily going to be able to kill every last one of their guys on the battlefield every time. It just doesn't work like that. Usually, after a number of defeats, though, you will be able to get every last one of their men, and that's what I'm hoping for. Keep them bouncing around, losing men, and not being able to work towards capturing anything. But they're actually building troops in my province. It's still owned by me, but occupied by them, so they're able to do that. And they're building an army there, which is just unacceptable. Hopefully, though, my allies over here will be able to occupy these cities and get them to declare peace. Well, although that's not a good thing. I don't want my ally to declare peace until I'm ready for them to declare peace. So they're building their troops, and they're trying to regain the glory of their army, which I don't want them to be able to do. So they finally captured, they occupy these two provinces, and now they're going after another one. So things are really looking good for me, thanks to my allies, which are really kind of helping me out here. Even though at first I kind of wrote them off as not being able to do a whole lot. So now, instead of 11% in the enemy's favor, because we conquered these provinces, it's now 11% in our favor. And once I capture Bangalore again, it'll be even higher in our favor. And that'll be really good.